better for me. Oh Jesus, you're too faithful to disappoint me. You've proven yourself in my life, and I've come to realize you're too faithful to fail.
What you say is what you do.
Lord, you never fail.
Have you been in presence? Okay, now I'm going to be ushering in my other honorable fountainers, and with me is Bukola Balogun. Welcome.
Hi,
welcome,
good
welcome,
morning.
Welcome. It's great to have you here.
It's great to see you.
It's too. A miracle to be here this morning, isn't it?
I know, right?
Oh my goodness.
Lagos be Lagos in this morning.
Ah, thank God for Pastor's prayer. And this morning, the Red Sea, we crossed it.
Yes, we passed it. Good morning. I am Bukola Balogun, and I hope you're all doing good. It's amazing to be here again this morning.
Yes. And we're not just two, you know, we have the Godhead, Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
We're all working together.
Yes. So joining us is our dear honorable fountainer, Precious Amile.
What is with the introduction this morning? We have to come in one after the other to introduce us. Good morning,
everyone. Holy Spirit filled.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. Day three of one explosion. I was trying to remember if it was two or three. Sunday was one, yesterday was two, and today's Tuesday is day three, the fifth session.
Yes, it's great to have you here, and we'd appreciate you telling us where you'll be joining us from on our social media platforms. On YouTube, we are Fountain TV. On Instagram, we are at the Fountain of Life Church. And on Facebook, what are we?
We're still the Fountain of Life Church on Facebook as well.
Precious, please, what's our senior pastor's handle?
I am Bat PJ.
Okay, this is so not nice. Hold, I know you know.
Relax, oh, okay, sorry.
Which of them is that? At Instagram, Facebook.
Instagram.
Because I am that PJ.
Okay, so you see, you can follow us on any of these platforms to join into Word Explosion Conference. I'm sure you're already either on your way to the office or at your office already. It's great to be here. So, where are we?
Yes, we're at the Word Explosion. That's where we are. Fountain of Life Church, Ilupeju Word Explosion. Yesterday was an amazing day. Let's talk about the first
Truly
session
amazing.
Before we even talk about the remarkable
evening session. Yes.
The first session. You know, one of those conferences that you attend, you know, very exclusive conferences you attend for, you know, CEOs, and they tell you you have to pay like maybe $50,000, and yeah, of course you're coming to Dubai. I'm not even joking, it felt that way.
I agree.
It actually did feel that way. It was really powerful. I think for one of the few times where, you know, I was so silent because I had to take everything in. If you miss a point, in fact, I and Buki were saying yesterday that, look, we need to go and watch it again.
Yes.
Because totally.
Everything he said made sense. So you really have to go back because you would have missed something. As he says something, as you are trying to put it down, there's something else is coming. And so you have to really go back and watch over and over again to get it, you know, all together.
Exactly. You know what she just said? It just reminded me of what the evening preacher said, Dr. Francis. He said when he interviewed Pastor Kunle Shorium that it was no longer an interview because he himself had to be taking notes. So imagine you're interviewing someone and you're taking notes because you're inspired by what the person is teaching. It's amazing. God is really at work. And Pastor Kunle touched on different aspects. I know this morning I said it's a miracle that we're here. Mm. I'm going to lean on the part where he said, mentioned the Red Sea. That the Red Sea is or was a spiritual truth, meaning that it was not just about parting the sea, the whole drama. The spiritual truth of that is the miracle behind it, of moving from the impossibility to possibilities in our life. I hope you caught that. And please don't forget to comment. Don't forget to tell us where you're joining us from, what country, what state, what you've learned so far during the week, what has imparted you the most.
So I would say, talking about Pastor Shorion, yesterday was really explosive, I must say. Yesterday was explosive. And that was going to be the first time I was going to be under his ministration.
See.
Yes. And he touched on a number of points. But, you know, one thing that struck me is, you know, for us to understand that there is a culture shift. Now, there are ways to which we have been used to handling things. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he mentioned methods on how we actually get to mission and methods. Now, the mission is constant.
True.
It is the method that evolves over time. And, you know, he made mention of culture. And if you get to look at it as individuals, as people who are used to culture and traditions, that if they tell us shift, it is hard.
Wahala.
You know, and we begin to look at other people from that lens of culture and we begin to judge other people. And he went as far as saying, instead of you looking at those people and judging them, why not try to understand them? It might be the method that is different to you.
True.
So try to look at it from the lens of methods changing as against thinking the mission, which is for us to go and preach the gospel to the whole world, is changing.
True. It just points back to the fact when he said, understand the new. Yes, it might not be what you're used to, just like the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Mm-hmm. It wasn't what they were used to. They were used to the law. They were used to the law of Moses. They were used to the commandments. So Jesus coming and simplifying it and not so simplifying it for them was not easily comprehensible by them because they couldn't understand how can you say you are the Messiah? Who are you to say you are the Messiah? Who are you to say you are older than our father Abraham? Knowing that the law was just a palliative for grace and Jesus is the embodiment of grace. That was another part that really touched me.
I thought you were going to start preaching another message.
No, not at all.
All right, so for me, I think that's one of the things I got. But the second one was really finding the meaning, you know, of everything. Everything has a meaning to
true.
It.
True. Yes.
Just beyond the use of it, there is a meaning to it. So I think for me, it talks about the curiosity approach to everything.
True.
So sometimes you use things because you know how to use them. You know they're used, but not really the meaning. And so looking at things that happen, and I'm not just talking about, you know, physical things, but when things happen, what is the meaning? What does this mean? And
asking
why. And then he talked about, you know, walking with the Holy Spirit in that perspective. And I like the fact that he brought everything was scriptural.
Yeah.
Because, you know, that could be, we have motivational speakers who would do that. But he brought that into the perspective of scripture, the Holy Spirit, the Word of God, prayer. And then he talked about walking with the Spirit. And for me, that was very important, to get the meaning of things.
Yes, very, very important. And it also leans on Pastor Awoshika's message when he said, aligning with the Spirit. She also talked about separating yourself and walking in alignment with the Holy Spirit. That once you walk in alignment with the Holy Spirit, nothing can go wrong because you have God's backing.
And you know the interesting thing?
Pastor Tulu also said that in the morning, when she was talking about the audacity for signs and wonders, she also mentioned, you know, that the audacious, you know, they're in alignment. She talks about alignment with the Holy Spirit.
This actually just says that the speakers that have been picked for this conference, aside from the fact that they were hand-picked deliberately because they are people who are walking with the Holy Spirit, means that somehow they are all in sync with the Holy Spirit. Because everything that they have been saying, they have been preaching, one way or the other, they are linking up to each other. And you know the interesting part of it is the Holy Spirit is the pastor of this church. Our late senior pastor, Pastor Taiwo, will always tell us that we should lean towards the Holy Spirit. And that is one thing the three or four speakers who have spoken so far have laid
emphasis on. I don't also think that they are approaching the pulpit casually. I don't think they're just coming to say, oh, I have an invitation, let me come and preach. A lot of spiritual work would have gone on behind the scene. And then, of course, it's the Holy Spirit. Because I'm sure there is a message he would want us to get in this season. And I'm sure we are already getting it. We'll find that common thread. But let's take the comments from us, YouTube and all our social media handles where we are streaming live at the moment. We're on YouTube Fountain TV. We have Queen Deborah Boss saying, good morning, Fountain of Life Church. Good morning to you, Deborah. We also have, Queen Deborah was also saying, good morning. Yes, okay, there was an issue earlier. She couldn't hear, but now she can hear very clearly in terms of the sound.
That's great. We also have Chim Dikende saying, good morning. Yes, good morning to you. Watching from Canada, thank you so much for joining us. And he also is talking about what he learned. Also, stewardship over ownership. That was what Pastor Kunle also bordered on, that our lives should be about stewardship, not just ownership, because if you already use the point of owning things, you cannot serve people. And the whole interconnectivity, stewardship over ownership, and Pastor Awoshika saying, you must be selfless. That the fact that you have power doesn't mean you should be selfish, doesn't mean it should be all about you. You are serving for the good of the people. That's why Jesus came to serve humanity. I think that's very interesting. We have Marie Mirembe from Uganda, our African sister. It's great to have you in church. Thank you for joining us from Kampala. Wow, Marie says, mind-opening sessions about audacity, changes or shifts from the old. We all have different altars. Always lean on the truth and you will never be let down. Hmm. Yes, yes, yes. And thank you for celebrating Fountain at 32. Thank you so much. Greatness with the Lord. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Marie.
All right, Akin Timei Kolawole says, waiting for today's session. Thank God for social media.
Yes, so.
Really having the time of my life. And this is on Facebook. And Buki Awolaja says, wonderful morning, church, and a wonderful morning to you as well. Imagine I was not so like just, social media.
Sorry. I just want to take this comment from Kenny. Oladipo Kenny says, good morning. It's day 3, and I'm already overloaded. Clearing my RAM to take in more today. The word has been coming explosive. Don't clear your RAM. Just get more storage.
Yes. Okay. Get more storage. I like that. Don't clear the RAM, right? But then imagine there was nothing like social media. And we had someone watching from Kampala. We have people watching from all over the world. And, you know, we definitely, the mission is for people to get to know what is happening in the house, for people to get familiar with what is happening yes. with the word. And imagine there is nothing to be able to project this to the world and people don't have the opportunity to be in the auditorium.
That's the method. Method has to change.
That's the method. Yes.
She gets it. All right. So evening was Dr. Francis Miles. And he talked about the altar.
Hmm.
It was perhaps the first time, I think we're discussing it.
Mm-hmm.
It was perhaps the first time I've heard, you know, someone preach about the altar, you know, in a very unique way, in a way that is specific to me. Because, you know, we talk about the altar, most time I have heard about it in terms of your prayer altar. But this is the first time, you know, someone is really talking about it in terms of your mission yes. and your purpose and what is unique to you.
Yes, the whole marketplace, altars. And I was just telling another honorable fountainer that Pastor Kunle's message and Dr. Francis' message, they bordered on marketplace. You being relevant, you being influential in your atmosphere, in your office, at home, in your community. What is that altar that God has given you? Divine ordination. He mentioned that divine ordination is better, supersedes artificial intelligence.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Divine intelligence supersedes artificial intelligence.
And yes, so he was mentioning, still talking about divine ordination. He mentioned, he was like, the design of your altar is to fit your divine ordination.
Yes.
And this was where he was laying emphasis on the fact that everyone, we don't have... Okay, we all have the same assignment, which is to preach Christ.
True.
The way we're talking about methods, the methods that we're going to go about preaching this is different. And that was why he was giving examples about a surgeon. Now, a surgeon might not necessarily go out there and go and heal the blind, you know, or go out there and go and pray. Or he made mention of a president. That imagine the president of your country comes and says, oh, he lays his hands on the sick and they are healed. And the country is in shambles, or she was mentioning inflation as the case is for Nigeria. So imagine misplacing your own priority. Your priority has to do with you ensuring that your altar, definitely you focus on your altar to ensure that wherever it is, whatever your ordination is, you're working effectively in that place.
Exactly.
While still doing this through your altar. So wherever it is that you might find yourself, there are ways for us to actually preach the gospel. You might just be talking to somebody, and who knows, and then the person gives our life to Christ. Doesn't necessarily mean they have to be binding and casting demons at the end of the day.
True. And still on divine ordination, what Dr. Francis preached, he mentioned that, you know, I'm going back to where he said, God cannot be contained by heaven, because he created heaven. So it cannot be contained by his creation. So if God has given you your own altar, he expects you to dominate that space. God is a God of dominance. He doesn't shrink for you. So whatever altar God has given you, he expects you to dominate that. And once you're in alignment, everything is fine.
And I remember Pastor Kunle also said that in the morning when he talked about, you know, God created heaven. So heaven is not where he lives.
Exactly. Mm.
Both of them repeated the same thing on the same day. But one of the I think analogies that I really loved from Dr. Francis Miles was the one of the transformer and the adapter. You know, where I'm like, oh wow. Now we'll never see the adapter the same way anymore. But, you know, I really loved that analogy. And it really, I mean, It's so simple.
Very, very.
And it helps you get it that, oh, this is what the altar does. You know, it tempers down the power in a way that you are able to plug in and you do not explode. I thought that was really powerful.
Yes, yes.
You know, he also mentioned the fact that you should understand your calling and effectively walk in it. And the only person who can make that possible for you to be able to understand your calling, definitely, is God himself. He's the one who calls us. So we have all been created for a reason. And you know, Jeremiah 1:5 says, before you were formed in your mother's womb, I knew you and I called you to be prophets to all nations. And so at the end of the day, understand what your calling is and work in it effectively. And he also mentioned that the highest form of calling is to be called to priesthood for every believer.
Yes, that every
we
believer
have been called to priesthood. So wherever it is that you find yourself, you are in entertainment, you are wherever you find yourself, we have been called to priesthood. And that actually goes to the scripture that talks about us going into the world, preaching the gospel to everyone.
Yes.
So wherever it is you find yourself, the highest calling, which is supposed to be the most important thing in our lives. It's supposed to be the number one thing, but most of the time, it's always the last, sadly. But that is supposed to be the number one.
What he said demystifies the idea of us being a royal priesthood, a chosen generation, kings, and gods. You know, it sort of demystifies it because most times people appropriate it to the altar, or to the pulpit rather, because we all think that, okay, it has to be on the pulpit. But he's saying, no, you are all that, but you have to be all that within your own specific calling and your own specific sector. So you're not waiting to be invited to minister before you display your giftings.
Yes. Exactly.
You already have them. Use them within the sector.
Yes.
And use whatever it is that is in your hands.
Exactly.
Whatever it is that is in your hands right now is enough for you for where you are at the moment. So if you think it is a phone you have, who knows? The phone might be working wonders. It might just be your life that you have. But make sure you're living your life in line with what Christ has said. And then, yes, that might just be ministering to somebody.
Yes, going on that, that was Pastor Kunle also shed light on that, where he said, in the garden, we had sand. And what does sand create? Glass. In the garden, you have trees. You might have a rubber tree. What does rubber do? It creates, example, tires. So use what you have. Ask God, how will I use what I have to glorify your name?
How can I effectively use what you have put in my hands
to glorify your name.
That was why I was laying emphasis on the fact that it's only God that understands the calling of your life, because he's the one who created you. He is the one who is the manufacturer of everybody on earth. So if you actually want to effectively maximize whatever it is that has been placed in your hands, you have to go to a manufacturer's manual to be able to effectively use it.
I think it was during the, wasn't the fasting week? Pastor Tulu mentioned it during one of her prayer, when she was leading prayers. You know, she mentioned the idea of, finding out your call and your purpose. And she did emphasize that, look, the most important thing is to actually, hear from God.
True.
That there is nothing as beautiful as that. And then, I think she also repeated during, the first session, that it's just, you can't, moving on, it just makes your life easier.
Yes. That's
when you have that, voice in your ears telling you this is the way to go, walk there.
Yes. That's why the Bible says, by strength shall no man prevail. And she also mentioned that the Holy Spirit is our earpiece. Just as you have your physical earpiece, the Holy Spirit is your navigation system to help you through, as our Honorable Fountain, your precious, just said.
Okay, so I think we'll just take some more comments because we'll have to leave now so that we get into the program.
This last one from Fola on our Fountain TV YouTube channel. He says, good morning from the United Kingdom. Good morning to
you. Good morning, Fola. You're welcome. So do not forget to share our handles to your friends, to your colleagues, to everyone you know at Fountain TV on YouTube. I am that PJ for our senior pastor on Instagram and on YouTube for our senior pastor. And what's it?
That's Jimmy Odukoya on YouTube and Toluwani Odukoya for our associate senior pastor, and the Fountain of Life, Fountain TV for YouTube, and that is for the Fountain of Life Church.
Yes, and on Instagram we are at the Fountain of Life Church, and Pastor Tolu's handle on Instagram is
Toluwani Odukoya.
Yes. So thank you so much for having us. I am Osero Naokini.
I am Bukola Balogun.
I am Precious Amayo.
enjoy the service and be ministered to. The Lord bless you richly. Always feel free to go through the sermons from Sunday to Monday to Tuesday, and we're here. So if you cannot join us online.
And then if you're in Lagos, you should run down.
You should find your way to the hall.
Just find a way to come down here. Just run down. Don't think about it. Just come down here.
Sorry, just finally. Pastor Shorin said yesterday that tell them I work here, coming to meet the doctor.
Yes, so.
Yes, because and to come with a doctor's report when you're going back.
Exactly. Just make sure you have doctor's report.
All right, thank you so much for watching.
You. Enjoy yourself.
You were created for something special, something extraordinary. Are you ready to be a sign and a wonder to your generation? The Fountain of Life Church presents Word Explosion Conference 2024. Come experience 8 days of divine revelations, transformative teachings, and powerful worship with the theme Signs and Wonders. The event holds from Sunday, April 14 to Sunday, April 21st. Speaking at the conference are renowned and seasoned preachers Bishop Mike Okonkwo, Bishop Tudor Bismarck, Dr. Francis Miles, Pastor Mike Todd, Apostle Joshua Selman, Pastor Ibukun Awoshika, and Pastor Kunle Shorinyo. Hosts are Pastor Jimmy Odukoya and Pastor Toluwani Odukoya. Venue is the Fountain of Life Church, 12 Industrial Estate Road, off Town Planning Way, Ilupeju, Lagos. The morning sessions will start at 9 a.m., while the evening sessions will start at 5 p.m. Don't miss this opportunity to encounter the supernatural and witness the manifestation of God's power. Word Explosion Conference of 2024, where faith meets with revelation and lives are changed forever. Tell somebody to tell somebody about it. You were created for something special, something extraordinary. Are you ready to be a sign and a wonder to your generation? The Fountain of Life Church presents Word Explosion Conference 2024. Come experience 8 days of divine revelations, transformative teachings, and powerful worship with the theme Signs and Wonders. The event holds from Sunday, April 14 to Sunday, April 21st. Speaking at the conference are renowned and seasoned preachers Bishop Mike Okonkwo, Bishop Tudor Bismarck, Dr. Francis Miles, Pastor Mike Todd, Apostle Joshua Selman, Pastor Ibukun Awoshika, and Pastor Kunle Shorinyo. Hosts are Pastor Jimmy Odukoya and Pastor Toluwani Odukoya. Venue is the Fountain of Life Church.
Wow, it's only one person I can hear that said amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Can we upstand, please? Thank you. Please, if you are up at the gallery, please, can you join us down here, please? If anyone is up at the gallery. Hallelujah. Nobody. Thank you. Wow. Wow. You know, we are indeed the best of times. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. We are indeed at the best of time. Today is the third day, first section, word explosion. Can I hear a shout? Can I hear a shout? Hallelujah. You know, we are moving at the speed of light. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's like a bullet train. We are just moving. We are just moving. We didn't even have time to catch our breath. Hallelujah. This morning, I just want to just thank God. Thank God for the first day, for the second day. Now, today is the third day. Hallelujah. It's getting hotter and hotter and hotter and hotter and hotter. Hallelujah. I'm sure the world has already exploded in our hearts. Hallelujah. You know, when something explodes, it turns to fragments. It scatters. Hallelujah. The world has exploded in our hearts. I just want to just say, Father, we thank you. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for yesterday. We thank you for Sunday. Father, we are thanking you in advance for today. Lord Almighty, Father, Lord, we thank you. Father, Lord Almighty, we thank you. We thank you for all the guest speakers, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for Pastor Oshika. We thank you for Pastor Kule. We thank you for Pastor Malisa. Father, Lord, we say thank you. Thank you for your word that have come forth, Lord Almighty, Father. Thank you for your word that have exploded in our hearts. Lord, we just want to worship you. Father, we want to say thank you, Lord. Thank you for our senior pastor, Pastor Jimmy Odukoya. Thank you, Lord Almighty, Father, for our associate senior pastor, Pastor Tolu Odukoya. Lord, we just want to thank you. We just want to thank you. Thank you for this gift you are giving this house. Lord, Father, we say thank you. We bless your holy name. We magnify your holy name. We exalt your holy name. In the mighty name of Jesus. You know, throughout the night, as I was praying, there was a particular song that keep coming to my heart. Though we are in the morning, but the song is still applicable. He said, I went for a meeting one night, and my heart saw the light. Something got a hold of me. I don't know about you, but me personally, something has gotten hold of me. Something has gotten hold of me. Something that there has been a shifting. Hallelujah. There has been a shifting. In my thinking, there has been a shifting. In my life, there has been a shifting. Hallelujah. What about you? Has there been a shifting? The word, we are not even halfway through yet. The word has exploded in my heart. Hallelujah. I want you to pray for yourself this morning. Are you expectant? Are you expectant? Because some of us should be at work this morning. But this is a sacrifice. On a Tuesday morning, we are here just to hear the word. It will be a disaster for me to hear the word and go back. That will never be our portion in the mighty name of Jesus. I want you to lay your expectation at the feet of Jesus this morning. I want you to array your expectation at the feet of Jesus this morning. I want you to tell God, here I am before you. Here I am before you. I am not before any man. I am not before any man. Here I am before you. Father, Lord Almighty, Father, Lord, I want a visitation over my life this morning. In the mighty name of Jesus, when the word is coming, let it begin to rearrange my life. Let it begin to change my life. Let it begin to manifest in my life. In the mighty name of Jesus, Father, Lord, I pray this morning, let there be a shifting. Let there be an explosion. In the mighty name of Jesus, let there be a change. In the mighty name of Jesus, in Jesus' mighty name. In the book of Acts, the lame man at the beautiful gate. Bible say he was there always. They put him there always just to beg for him. Hallelujah. But when Peter and John got there, his life was completely changed. Amen. Now, the most unique thing was that when they took him and entered into the temple, people were surprised. There was a confusion in the temple. People were saying, is it the person that sat at the foot of at the entrance of the temple begging? Some say, no, it's not him. Some say, no, it looked like him. Some say, no. Some say, yes, it's him. There was a confusion because a shift has taken place. Because a change has taken place. Because something has happened to him that people were surprised. People could not fathom it. People could not recognize it. How can somebody that we saw a while ago suddenly walking into the temple to pray whole and hearty? I want you to pray this morning for yourself. That when I walk out here, at the end of this first session, this third day, people will not recognize me. In the mighty name of Jesus. Spiritually, physically, materially, in every ramification of my life, people will not recognize me. recognize me in the mighty name of Jesus. Malekanta ribaria, rekeseke terere, milala dere bondere, marikandere barari, likato sokendaria bondaria, makesoke riba ba 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 ba, renderi bosiara bonde, makoto sekatara. Father Lord, here we are this morning in the mighty name of Jesus. We have come to meet with you. We have come, Father, at your feet this morning in the mighty name of Jesus. Anna came to your feet. Bible say you did it for her in the mighty name of Jesus. That is your seed. She was called barren, become a mother of many in the mighty name of Jesus. Father Lord, I pray this morning in the mighty name of Jesus. The forgotten one, Lord mighty Father. Bible say when it was time, Lord mighty Father, for Mordecai to be lifted. Bible say the king could not sleep in the mighty name of Jesus. As we are come back before you this morning, our helper will not be able to sleep in the mighty name of Jesus. As the word is coming to us this morning, Lord Almighty Father, is transcending every barrier, is breaking all every barrier, is breaking every yoke in our life in the mighty name of Jesus. He's taking us, Lord Almighty Father, Lord, what we need to achieve, Lord Almighty Father, 100 years or 10 or 20 years, he's taking us a day, 24 hours to achieve it, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. A supernatural turnaround, a change, a shift in our life in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, I pray, Lord Almighty Father, say word explosion, the word of God, Lord Almighty Father, Lord, this third day, this first session shall explode in our heart in the mighty name of Jesus. My God, my Lord, when he explode every fragment, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus, fragment of barrenness, Lord Almighty Father, Lord, I pray, Lord Almighty Father, eternal, Lord Almighty Father, to a mother of many in the mighty name of Jesus. Fragment, Lord Almighty Father, of sickness, eternal into supernatural divine healing in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you this morning. Hallelujah. Hebrew. Open the Bible to Hebrew 12. Hallelujah. From 22. He said, but we have come to Mount Zion and the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable companies of angels, to the general assembly and the church of the firstborn who is registered in heaven. Hallelujah. We have come to Mount Zion. This is our Mount Zion. We have come to Mount Zion. Hallelujah. And to the city of the living God. The city of the living God. Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord. My God, we thank you, Lord. Because this is our Mount Zion. This is the dwelling place of God. We have come, Lord Mighty Father, to meet with you, Lord. And we know, Father, our life will never be the same again. In the mighty name of Jesus, Father, we pray for those who are on the way, Lord Mighty Father. You will quicken their steps. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray, Lord Mighty Father, traffic, Lord Mighty Father, shall be good this morning. In the mighty name of Jesus, we declare, Lord Mighty Father, Lord, we hand over this service unto you. And we declare this morning, Lord Almighty Father, that shall be a supernatural visitation. That shall be a supernatural touch. In the mighty name of Jesus, that shall be a shift. That shall be a change. In the mighty name of Jesus, everyone here this morning, by the time we leave, Lord Mighty Father, we will become unrecognizable in the mighty name of Jesus. Your word, Lord Mighty Father, will manifest in our life in the mighty name of Jesus. People will say, is it you? No, it's not you. Is it you? No, it's not you. There is something about you. There is something about you. What I'm seeing about you. Ah, it's a glorious praise of the Lord in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. Father, we worship you. Father, we say thank you. Father, indeed, it is good for us to be here. Matthew 17, when Jesus Christ was transfigured, before his disciple. And Peter made a statement. He said, it is good for us to be here. It is good for us to have witnessed this transfiguration. It is good for you and me to be here this morning, because we are going to be witnessing the supernatural in the mighty name of Jesus. We are going to be seeing what we have not seen before in the mighty name of Jesus. We are going to be experiencing what we have not experienced before in the mighty name of Jesus. Oh Lord Almighty Father, we are going to build a tent, not a physical tent, but a spiritual tent in the life of every individual in the mighty name of Jesus. Ah, Lord Almighty Father, after the end of today, you will tell yourself, I'm glad that I was in church this morning. I am glad I was in church this morning in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you this morning. Father, we worship you this morning. We commit, Father, the guest speaker into your hands, Lord Mighty. Father, you will use him mightily. Your word will come out of his mouth ceaselessly in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, Lord, as your word is coming, Lord Mighty, Father, it will find a dwelling place in our heart in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, Lord, that the seed of your word, Lord Mighty, Father, will bring hundredfold in our heart in the mighty name of Jesus. It will transform us. It will change us, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. It shall be said of us, see what the Lord has done. In the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. Father, we worship you. I commit our senior pastor into your hands, our associate senior pastor, and every pastor in the Fountain of Life Church, and every member, sir, every worker, sir, every volunteer, sir, for this program, I commit them into your hands, Lord Mighty Father. Walk through each and every one of us in the mighty name of Jesus. Let your mercy speak for us. Let your grace be manifest in our lives. In the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we bless your name. Lord, we worship you. To you all the glory, honor, praises, and majesty, now and forevermore. In Jesus' mighty name, we are prayed.
Can I hear louder? Amen. Hallelujah. It's World Explosion Conference Day 3. Let's celebrate the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Are we excited this morning?
Yeah. Yeah.
Somebody give God a loud praise.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. We're excited to be in the presence of the Lord. Bible says this is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in
yes.
it. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Lord, what name fits you? And he said, above every health challenge, above every financial challenge. All glorious God,
all glorious
we praise your name.
We praise your name.
Only you are God. Only you is only you.
Baba si soro mi dayo.
Baba si soro mi dayo.
Ewa ba mi yo.
Ewa ba mi yo.
Mamore, mamore.
Mamore, mamore.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Daddy.
Baba si soro mi dayo.
Baba si soro mi dayo.
Ewa ba mi yo.
Ewa ba mi yo.
Mamore, mamore.
Mamore, mamore.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Daddy.
Baba si soro.
You love me too much, oh.
Too much, oh, excess love, oh.
Yeah, Jesus, you love us too much, oh.
Testimony, you love us too much. Your love is indescribable. The depths of your love unfathomable. We can never get out of your love. We just can never get out of your love. Father, we say thank you. And for this house, the Fountain of Life Church, without a doubt, we know it. The world can see it, that you love us specially. Father, we bless you. Father, we thank you. Father, we honor you. For this holy convocation this week, you've gathered us to yourself. And just like you are, to do us good and nothing else. Father, we say, blessed be your holy name. Thank you. 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 We can never say it enough. Father, we bless you this morning. Thank you for another time in your presence. We will not leave the same. Blessed be your holy name. In Jesus' name, we have prayed. Hallelujah. Let's just give a clap offering to Jehovah. It's so beautiful to just come into his presence continually. I know that it's just going to be a fresh touch. You know, it's only God that can touch you differently every single time. I mean, most of us, either written down or in our heads, there's a timetable of food in your house. You know, in the morning on Monday, this, that. At times it tastes different. It's the same bread and egg, but we don't know. This one is very sweet. But another day, what's wrong with this food? But never with God. Every single time, is a fresh and beautiful touch that moves us forward. We can trust him completely. You know, there's no one else you can trust completely. Man may mean well, but human frailties and limitations. But with God, we can trust him completely. That he's always on our side. He's always for us. He's always for our good. Even at times when it's going on and it's like, Father, I can't really understand. I can't really see you here. But we can trust him. So this morning, just lift your hands and say, Father, I thank you for a fresh touch, for a fresh visitation. Choir, before you take your own song, within my time, just as I was there, this song just came to me by Brother Ducey. I can see him, I can sense him, the King of glory is here. Can we take a few times?
I can see him.
Oh yes.
I can see him.
The King of glory is here. Hallelujah! He's here!
I can feel him, I can sense him. The King of glory is here.
Atire tire
uka. I can see
him. He's here!
Atire tire uka.
He's here for you!
Atire tire uka.
To do us good!
Atire tire uka.
To move us forward! Can you feel it?
I can feel him, I can sense him, the King of glory is here.
I can feel him,
I can feel him,
I can sense him,
I can sense
and know
the King of glory is here.
Can you feel him?
I can feel him.
Oh yes,
I can sense him.
He's in this house,
the King of glory is here.
I feel
him.
He's here.
Come on.
Come on. He's here to bless you and me.
Come on.
For the last time, can you feel him?
I can feel him. I can sense him. The King of glory is here.
Can you see him?
I can feel him. I can sense him. The King of glory is here.
To do us good, he's here. Can you feel him? Can you sense him? The King of glory is here. Atire tire uka. Sheda dalede.
Come on.
Sheda dalede. Atire tire
uka.
Oh yes, he's here.
Come on.
We welcome you to day 3, session 1. Be assured that the King of glory is here. You know, it's just that he is God. If he were a man, we'll say he has left every other place. And this is where he is now. We will say he has left every other place. And for this week, he's always with us, so he will never go. But you see, this special week, this holy convocation, we will know that Jehovah has visited us. Eternal fruits. Fruits of the now. Fruits of the present that even the blind will see. So please don't get distracted. Come every session. And you know, we will be here, but we will return to watch them all over again. And Pastor Kunle said yesterday, you can be assured in any minute, what you really hear is about 80%. You have to keep hearing and hearing and hearing. So please keep inviting people. Keep inviting people. It's still until Sunday. And come prepared with your heart. We welcome our online community. We know there's so many people joining us online. And we know that you'll be mightily blessed. Can we take our seats as we're blessed by the best choir this side of heaven?
Thank you. this life that I have is the life of God in me. This life that you have is the life of Christ. This joy that you have is the joy of the Holy Ghost. Somebody rejoice. Rejoice. Come on, you can do better than that. How many of you have eternal life living in you? Come on. Speak in other tongues. Acknowledge the one who lives in you. The creator of the universe lives in you. The fountain of life, he resides in me. Jesus. Come on. I'm the image of the loving God. He gave me a priceless gift, the Holy Ghost. Through me, God is revealed. My God, I am saved eternally in Christ. Do I have witness? Say, wherever you are, just sing with us. Come on. He gave me a priceless gift, the Holy Ghost. Through you, God is revealed. Come on. Come on.
I have Zoe.
I've got some witness here.
I have Zoe.
It's the Spirit of God.
Spirit of God
lives inside of me.
I have Zoe.
The life of Christ.
Life of God
is what I have. One more time, say.
I have Zoe.
Come on, hallelujah.
Lives in me.
Okay, at this point, testify. Say Zoe.
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 Eternal life is living inside.
Hey, the solution.
Zoe.
I am not commanded. Zoe.
Zoe.
Come on.
Zoe.
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 Zoe. Come on, say,
this life
that I have
is the life,
the same life,
this life.
Away. I don't know what you're going through. There's power in Zoe. Healing in Zoe. Favor in Zoe. Direction. Power in Zoe, you said. Healing in Zoe. Favor.
Favor in Zoe.
Direction in Zoe.
Direction in Zoe.
I have a witness within me. There is
power.
favorites away.
Favorites away.
It's all within me. Hallelujah.
Wherever you're sitting, just lift up your voice and sing this song.
This life that I have is the life of God in me. This life that I have is the life of Christ. This joy that you have is the joy of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Jesus. Zoe, Zoe. Zoe,
Zoe.
Zoe,
Zoe.
Come on.
Zoe,
Zoe.
Zoe.
Never take any detail of our walk with God for granted. You see, access is such a privilege. Access is the ultimate. You see, if somebody gives you access, that's one of the greatest gifts that person can give you. And then when the Almighty God gives us unfettered access, because the ultimate price was paid, may we never take it for granted. If you walk anyhow in front of any surroundings of Aso Rock, you will be arrested. Because you have to explain yourself what you are doing there. I remember years ago when Dodan Barracks was still the functional, you know, seat of the state. I know a woman who, you know, she was going to another place, Ribadu Road and everything there. She was going somewhere there. I said, can you call, turn left, turn right. Anyway, she turned right, found herself in front of the damn barracks. Before she could say, this does not look like she was surrounded. I can't remember how many hours they questioned her. The fact that she was a woman, that helped her. Because if it was a man, some slaps would probably have. You will explain yourself how you got there. She was there for, I can remember, this was years ago, 3-4 hours. They brought out her profile. They had all her ancestors. They had found out which village she was from. It was not a laughing matter. It taught me something more about access. But Jehovah, we just come. In your space, you just say, Father. You should have a special name for God. That when he hears that name, that must be Tosi. We just come and we have complete and total access. May we never take access for granted. Consider it a privilege. It is a privilege till we see him face to face. And you see, God gives so much. He gives us everything. So the few things we can give him overdose. Let him know that this my child. Don't be deceived, though. Everything counts with God. Is it not God that said, I have found a man after my heart? The first day I read that when I got born again, I said, Father, this is my goal in life. This morning, before Pastor Jimmy comes with the guests, it's your time with your Father. Give him worship. He desperately craves worship. Always. He can never get enough. When you love somebody, you satisfy, over-satisfy the person with what the person wants. Mothers, you know your child's favorite dish. This dish must land today. Your husband's favorite dish. Your wife. How? We're made in the image of God. Every feeling, virtue, expression of love that we have is from him. And he desires it. Just lift your hands this morning. Just you and your God. Just you and him. I love you more than anything. I love you. You're the only one. I love you, my King. Lord, I give my life to you. All over again, I'm yours. Lord, I give my life to you. Tell him you love him. Father, I'm crazy about you. I love you. More than anyone. I love you. Much more than anyone. I love you, Lord. More than anyone. I love you. My Father. Lord, I give my life to you. All over again, I declare I'm yours.
Lord, I give my life to you.
I love you, 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 Lord. I love you, my King.
More than anything,
more than anyone. I love you forever, my King. All over again, I give my life.
Lord, I give my life to you.
I am your own. I am your own. Till the day you return, Jesus, I am your own. I am your own.
I am your own.
Father, we submit ourselves to you. We open up our hearts, our minds, our spirits to receive from you this morning. We thank you that the entrance of your word bringeth light. We thank you that in you was the light of men, and this light shines in darkness, and darkness cannot comprehend it. So, Father, as we go into this session, we thank you for the life-changing word that will illuminate our minds. In the name of Jesus. So, Father, we give you glory. We give you honor. All adoration and thanksgiving be unto you. In Jesus' matchless name. If you believe it, say amen. Three, the morning session of Word Explosion Conference. And if you are in the building this morning, it's because you are intentional. This is not the general session for everyone. This is particularly speaking to leaders, to ministers, to people who are taking the time. You could be anywhere on this Tuesday morning, but you are in the building. And that is because you are intentional. Celebrate. Yes, you can clap for yourselves. And we have the privilege. Some people were blessed last night. I mean, you know, I said a good preacher makes you want to go read your Bible even more. You know, you hear a good word and you're like, ah, wait, is this the same? Altar. I said, but I know altar. You know, but in the dimension in which it's like everyone has an altar. And it is the way God speaks to us specifically through the altars he set up for us to take over. And my mind was blown. We're just talking about it yesterday. I said, God bless Dr. Miles. Appreciate the gift of God in him. And today, he's going to continue speaking to us this morning. And I am so excited. If we can have them bring the ushers, can we bring this down, please? You know, in these sessions, we want to be close, a bit more intimate. And so for those who missed yesterday, get ready. And while they do that, please turn your attention to, let's wait for them. Thank you. Please appreciate our ushers. Thank you, sirs. This is good. Could you move it a bit forward, please? This room. There we go. Could you please turn your attention to the screen as we...
Dr. Francis Miles. Dr. Francis Miles is an apostle, minister, conference speaker, and author who currently resides in the United States of America. He's a multi-gifted international motivational speaker, best-selling author, business consultant, and apostle to the nations. He is the senior pastor of Royal Priesthood International Church in Tempe, Arizona. He has written several books, including The Order of Melchizedek, a foundational book that breaks the barriers between religion and business. He's also the founder of the Order of Melchizedek Supernatural School of Ministry, a training school for business leaders, government officials, and pastors to find their purpose in the Order of Melchizedek. He has been a featured guest on Seed Rock's It's Supernatural TV show, and This Is Your Day with Benny Hinn. In 1989, Dr. Francis Miles had a face-to-face encounter with the risen Christ when the power of God snatched him from the bed of sickness. He carries a strong anointing for healing and prophecy and a burning passion to see the body of Christ enter into the order of Melchizedek as kings and priests unto God. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Francis Miles.
Please put your hands together this morning for Dr. Francis Miles. Appreciate you, sir. Turn it on.
Praise the Lord. Come on, Fountain of Life Church.
Give Jesus a glorious praise. Hallelujah. My God, I love this church. Yesterday, last night, Pastor Jimmy began to show me your Easter production. I was blown away. I'm like, I can watch this on Broadway in New York. It was that good. And I prophesy, I want to work with you, man of God. You know, come on, somebody. Amen. I can't act, but I can do some things in America. So I want to see how I can help Pastor Jimmy with certain things. I'm so love him and Pastor Tolu. Put hands together for them. Just amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You can take your seats just for a few seconds before we read the first scripture. Tonight you're going to be hearing from my bishop, Bishop Tudor Bismarck. He's a dear friend and my bishop. I'm part of the African Council of Apostles by the special grace of God. And I wrote a book on the Battle of Altar, Spiritual Encounter, Spiritual Technology for Divine Encounters that he autographed. And the man that's coming, I believe, this week, my friend Joshua Selman, he told me that it is one of the best teaching on altars. He told me himself, he said, Dr. Miles, you have some of the best teaching on altars of any man I know in the earth today. And that's saying a lot coming from Joshua, Apostle Joshua. So I'm looking forward to seeing him. I hear that he's on the list of people coming. I wrote a book called The Joseph of Arimathea Calling, about the calling, and the Lord spoke to me. He said, I'm going to raise kingdom paymasters in the last days who can pay the bills of the kingdom. And he said to me, one of the anointings of the last days is a masterful anointing in business. And the Lord said to me that the business anointing is going to be elevated as it was in the beginning, so shall it be at the end. It was a businessman called Joseph of Arimathea who rescued the body of Jesus from the hand of Pontius Pilate after Jesus was dead. You know, you have no understanding how big that was, that Jesus Christ be rescued, because he was condemned a Roman prisoner. So as a matter of fact, as far as Rome was concerned, he was a property on Rome. That's why Pontius Pilate did everything he could not to take over the trial. Because the moment he took over the trial, it became a legal official trial of Rome. And Roman law applied and Jewish law was suspended immediately. So God needed a masterful negotiator who can negotiate the body of Jesus out of the hands of Rome. And he didn't use an apostle or a prophet who can prophesy. He used a man who can write a check. His name was Joseph of Arimathea. It's a very powerful teaching for business people. It lets you look at the wealth discussion from a whole different angle. See, there are realms of dominion where the anointing you need is not praying in tongues, it's writing checks. And I'm beginning to come into that realm in America because I'm even now there were, you know, when you become a donor, okay, I'm a Republican in America, but now we are entering the donor class. So sometimes when you're a donor class and they know you can write some checks, you'll be amazed where they invite you. And I believe God wants to raise Arimatheas in Nigeria. Talk to me, somebody. That when the church is in trouble as a matter of political policy, we've got Arimatheas who can go behind the veil and politicians can listen to them and things change. I don't know, behind the curtains, that one of us went there and did something that changed everything. That is the teaching on Joseph of Arimathea. Tithes of honor is tithing under the order of Melchizedek. One of the reasons why tithing is such a controversial subject, should not be, is because most people that teach it have no understanding of the Melchizedek order and priesthood. Tithing does not begin with Levi, it begins with Melchizedek. And it was given to Abraham after he had a lot of money, not before. Which means tithing, the essence of tithing is not to give you money, is to protect you from what money brings into people's lives once they have it. Issuing divine restraining orders from the courts of heaven is a very powerful teaching on the judicial side of the kingdom. I'm a man who's all things Apple. I'm an Apple guy. Recently I lost my iPod. So I went to a hotel in Zambia. It's a nice hotel. But I went to have breakfast and I forgot my very expensive iPods. And somebody, one of the hotel workers, felt like the Lord was blessing them that morning. So they took my iPods, and 5 hours later, I remembered I couldn't find them. But thank God, I didn't buy a Samsung, it's Apple. So, listen, Samsung is stealable, not Apple. So I took my phone. I told my son, come here. I've lost my Apple. But whosoever took my nice iPod doesn't know Apple technology. So I went to my find my iPods. And I a miracle happened. My iPods were walking all over Zambia. I said, man, that's prophetic. So I took my, gave my son, and one of my sons is the head of the police in Zambia. He got off, and together they went. They found a guy. They found a guy, and they told him, he said, are you the ones with the iPods? No. What are you talking about? And so my son, I told him what to do. He opened up the app, and he made them sing. Ding, 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 ding. And I said, oh, my God, I'm so sorry. I don't know. I mean, the man was on the floor. Please don't get my job. I said, don't fire him. And he's already, I just wanted my iPods, you know. I said, but I tell him that compliments of iPod technology, okay? But anyway, I was watching an article. There was this article that I saw in America. I'm reading, and it was about Apple was suing Samsung because one of their phones Samsung produced was so like the iPhone that Apple in California was convinced this was a reverse engineering of their technology. It became a massive case. So now I'm reading the article, and the article goes like this. In the article, a Californian female judge was presiding over the case, issued a temporary restraining order on Samsung for the global sales of this particular iPhone under question. And she said, I'm putting a temporary restraining order on this. Samsung must withdraw all sales, freeze all sales of this product. Now remember, at the time, Samsung had sold millions of that particular phone. And I'm reading the article, and the article goes like this, that Samsung headquarters made a communication with all their branches all over the world to pull that phone until the judge had adjudicated the case. And as I'm looking at that, the Holy Spirit speaks to me. I didn't even know God was reading the newspaper with me. He kind of ambushed me on this thing. He said to me, did you see that? I said, what are you talking about? He said, what you just read? I said, yeah. He said to me, here is a female judge in California without breaking a sweat from the power of a judicial office. She writes an order that is globally obeyed by a multi-billion dollar corporation. They are making money, but in spite of the fact they are making money, they don't rebel. The entire corporation of Samsung globally responded to the restraining order. And God said to me, and yet my people don't come to me for divine restraining orders. Am I not a judge? That was the beginning of an oracle that would change the world. My book became number 100 on Amazon for 2 weeks, unheard of in Christendom in America. I got number 100 on Amazon. That's a space for Dan Brown, John Grisham. Very rarely do you find a Christian book making the Amazon 100. Why? Because the algorithm is ruthless. It ranks your book every hour because they are trying to make money. You know, and Amazon has millions of titles. My book got to number 100 next to John Grisham and Dan Brown. That one on restraining orders. It's one of the most, it exploded so much sales. But what I love about it more than anything else is the miracles people are getting from applying the revelation. To me, I believe in the theology of practice. Amen. We can talk about things, but when you can demonstrate, it's even better. I speak to the earthly least prosperity. Is a book I wrote when witches in Zambia tried to kill me using dirt, and the Lord used what the enemy meant for evil to show me that the earth is not dead, she is alive and can be spoken to. You know, and you'll be amazed what the Bible has to say about the earth is, how dynamic the earth is. Ever since I wrote that book, Sid Roth actually asked me to do a television show on it because there were so many miracles connected to this revelation alone. People couldn't have property getting property. People lost their property getting it back. People lost titles appearing supernaturally. It's amazing. You know, get the book. It'll be a blessing to you. I have a teaching on it on YouTube. Maybe you can look for Francis Miles on YouTube. You might be surprised what you find. Amen. By simply clicking to subscribe, it costs you nothing, but it can change everything. Following the footsteps of Rabbi Jesus became my final thesis on the courts of heaven, because the one who introduced the courts of heaven in the New Testament theology was Jesus. Nobody ever talked about the courts of heaven in the New Testament theology until Jesus came. It's everywhere, plastered in the Old Covenant. Daniel talks about it. You know, Zechariah talks about it. You know, so many portions of the Tanakh speak about the courts of heaven, that God has a real place where judicial activity and verdicts are rendered that affect the course of people and nations. And as a matter of fact, the judicial system of the earth is templated, is a shadow of the higher priesthood, is a shadow of the higher court system that is in heaven. As a matter of fact, if that court rules, there's no court on earth that can overrule, because it's about superiorness. In America, for instance, the nine justices is where it ends in America. Once they saw those nine justices say it is what it is, no matter if you like it, it ends all debate. Can I tell you that the court of heaven is the supreme court over every judicial system known to man? You know, and so we have actually changed verdicts that were made in American court systems by taking people to the courts of heaven. You know, it's amazing. My book, The Order of Melchizedek, I've produced over 6,000 students out of this curriculum. I built a school on the order of Melchizedek, because I really believe that how it began is how it's going to end. The first shall be last, and the last shall be first. You know, the first priesthood known to man, revealed to man, was revealed to Abraham. It was Melchizedek. It was a priesthood where a man can be both king and priest in the same station. That is the order of priesthood. But once you get down to Moses, because the people are so hard-headed, God had to break down what was integrated as a technology in Melchizedek, becomes broken down in Israel. So now you have kings on one side, you have God priests on one side. Anytime you have humanity on different sides of the pendulum, they're going to begin to divide what God has already united. So now you find the priesthood among the Levites, you find the kingship among the kings, but nothing was ever really connected. And you see political fights between the kings and the priests. It's not what God intended. Because in the order of Melchizedek, we are both. We are kings and priests. You know, I can prophesy, I can teach, but at the same time, baby, I can do business like the best of them. Okay? Amen? Come on, somebody. Amen? All right. Let's stand up for the reading of God's word. These books are here because I'm going to be here, because I just want to enjoy the conference. You know, thank you for Pastor Jimmy letting me stay long. Amen. Hallelujah. Just pray that I don't overstay my welcome. Amen. There's always come on, somebody. Amen. But because I'm going to be here, I just want to enjoy Bishop tonight. I mean, it's so good today. You know, this is my most exciting service. You know why? Because after today, I'm going to be lazy like everybody here. Amen. Because I'm done, okay? I'm just going to be here just enjoying everybody, just shouting with you guys. It's going to be good. Amen. Hallelujah. So I want everybody to turn in your Bibles to Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 11 to 13. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 13 to 11. And I'm going to be using your New King James Version. Amen. By the Spirit of the Lord, we're going to read it together as loudly as we can, and then you can take your seat. What I'm going to present this morning, I can tell you it's going to really bless you. It's going to bless you because it's going to really challenge you in your how you walk with God. I think, you know, this is really a teaching about how God works with men. You know, Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 11 to 13. Are you ready? Okay, after count of three, let's read it together as loudly as you can. 1, 2, 3, read. Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me saying, Jeremiah, what do you see? And I said, I see a branch of an almond tree. Then the Lord said to me, you have seen well. I am ready to perform my word. Verse 13. And the word of the Lord came to me the second time saying, what do you see? And I said, I see a boiling pot and it's facing away from the north. Somebody say amen. Amen. Now turn to your neighbor and say, what do you see? And ask him again. I mean, say, really, what do you see? It's very interesting, amen, that that's what God would ask a man, Jeremiah, at the infancy of his ministry. It would seem to me that the divine is more concerned not about a person's theology as much as what they can see. Because you can always clean up theology, but what I found in working with God, it's very difficult sometimes to change what people see. No matter what you say to people, if they don't see themselves successful, success is not going to come no matter how anointed you are. Tell your neighbor, what do you see? Tell them, as you sit here at Word of Explosion, what do you see? Where do you see? Tell them now, where do you see your life going? 2, 3 years? 5 years? Father, I thank you for the anointing. I thank you for the mystery, for the revelation. This is a beautiful, I sense the cool breeze. The Ruach of God is so beautiful this morning. So I know, Father, let your wind, the soft, gentle blow of the wind of the Spirit, guide the teaching deeper into our spirit. Because Lord, tonight, to this morning, it's going to feel like we're in the desert at an oasis drinking cool, fresh water. In Jesus' name. And beginning to now allow you to get into spaces we've not understood or allow you to get into, so you can lift us. For you are a God who lifts men. Lift our heads. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Take your seats. You know, when I was studying, what I'm going to invite you into this morning is a conversation I've been having with God, because the older I get, the more I become concerned about time. The currency of time becomes very important, because you begin to realize that destiny is played against the calendar of time. And you want to make sure that whatever it takes for God to use you, if it can take 3 months, don't make it take 3 years. Is that right? Because so much can happen with God if you can quickly align with God's will of doing things. Because the reality about God is, he's not going to bend to how you do it. He expects you, absolutely, as a sovereign and having foreknowledge, he wants you to bend to his way of seeing things. He may empathize with your experiences that could be traumatic, that could explain your hesitancy in responding to the divine. But when it's said and done, you must bow. If you want God to be the one that uses you and do something powerful in your life. You know, so I've given myself a study to, you know, in scripture, one of my studies I've given myself to is why men rise and others do not rise within the same house. That it will be God speaking the same thing to everybody, and then you come back a year or two later, some people have risen to pinnacles of success, you know, that are glorious, and the people that were in the same conference are actually gone back further. They have retrogressed further. And so I've studied this issue, because above everything else, knowing what I'm coming from, amen, I want to be used by God more than anything else. And I realize that there's a calendar I'm working against. You know, in the NFL, or any NFL, even in the NFL, when you hit the 2-minute mark in a game, the intensity of the game explodes. The reason it explodes, because talent at that moment doesn't mean anything but the clock. And so teams begin to manage the clock. If you are behind, you know, then you have to really change. You can't play it safe anymore, because you have already hit the 2-minute mark. And I'm telling you the most amazing thing, that in the NFL, the last 2 minutes are the fastest minute. It's like when you're watching the whole game, there's something about the last 2 minutes. The intensity rises. And you say, whatever I didn't get right, it doesn't matter. You know, and most championship coaches, they have a grid they work from. Once the 2-minute mark, even the best quarterbacks like Tom Brady was known. He was an assassin when the 2 minutes. See, it's amazing what time, losing time, time is working against you, does to certain people. Some people, it paralyzes them. Some people, their senses become heightened. They've got to win this thing. So whatever mistakes I've made yesterday, I've got to fix it, because at the end of the day, I'm going to have a W behind my name. You know, so I've really spent time looking at these issues in life. Amen. And I don't think you are here at Word of Explosion this morning when others are working. They will join us tonight, you know, just because you have no other place to be. I think some of you took time off, do all kind of things. So I want to make this morning meaningful. Can I do that? So I'm always very careful to take very seriously the questions that come from the mouth of the divine, because God is all answers. So when he's asking a question, it's not because he needs to know himself. It is because questions are the quickest way to locate the student and help align them quickly, so they don't waste their time. So God, as he talks to young Jeremiah, the first thing he tells him, what do you see? You know, God is like, I'm not even going to care about your theology, God. I can always deal with that later. Right now, what do you see? Because what you see will determine, will tell me how long it's going to take for me to raise you as a voice to your generation. Because the truth of the matter is, this is what separates men and women in the house of God, is what do you see? What do you see? So I'm going to work with this over several scriptures. And I'm telling you to be very meaningful. You know, very rarely am I between two titles. You know, but right now, I'm really struggling because even though I've given you the title, what do you see? There's another title that is competing for the same message. So I'm just going to give you both. And hopefully at the end, we can connive, we can synchronize the two titles. Is that okay? So the second title I was thinking for this message is the curse of the curious case of our physical eyes. Say with me, the curse. Now, when I say the curse, it's just because of my pronunciation, it's C-U-R-A, is it right? C-U-R-A-S-E, that's it. The curse of the curious case. Now, the second curse is C-A-A-S-E. Does that make sense? The curse of the curious case of our physical eyes. So, God says to Jeremiah, what do you see? And when Jeremiah tells him what he sees, and God finds that what the man is seeing and what the divine are seeing are synchronized, God says, oh, then you have seen well. Because if you can see what I'm seeing, then you have seen well. Now I can hasten my word into performance. Meaning that seeing clearly, seeing what God is seeing, actually hastens divine performance. So when there's lack of divine performance in human life, I can always ask you the first question, you know, because I do spiritual and business consulting. The first thing is, what are you seeing? Because if you're not, if there's no divine performance, God is telling, God in this passage is tying, attaching divine performance to the seeing of a man of God. If you can't see what I'm seeing, then I'm going to stay on the same place, begin to work with you until I can get you to a place where you are seeing what I'm seeing. Because until then, there'll be no divine performance. The question of what do you see is so important to God. He asks it a second time. Always notice whenever God repeats himself. The principle at hand is an immutable and negotiable principle of how spirits move. He asks him again, what do you see? And the boy twice passed the test. I see a boiling pot. You know, I see a boiling pot. You know, and God again says, you have seen well. I've seen a boiling pot. It's facing from the well, from the north. When God is now convinced that this man has eyes of the spirit to see what the divine can see, God knows this journey is going to be fast. It's going to be fast because the reason there are different levels of speed in divine activity in people's lives is because of this issue. For some people, it doesn't take a lot for God to make them see, you know, what he wants them to see. For some people, it takes 10 years of teaching, you know, finagling before they finally see it. By the time they see it, somebody has that 10 years of speed. Because he's been seeing, it doesn't take a lot. And so I'm asking for the Lord to help you so that, you know, your vision. Today, everybody's going to get a vision check from the Holy Spirit and a visual adjustment. Amen? So with that as a background, we now move on to a mystery that I've only become to understand. You know, it's Genesis 3, you know, that the fall of man had a lot to do with the fall of man had a lot to do with sight as much as it had to do with the eating of the forbidden tree. As a matter of fact, now I'm now convinced that the only reason Satan wanted them to eat of the forbidden tree is because it was after their sight. And you're going to see something very interesting here. Turn in your Bibles to the book of Genesis chapter 3. Come on, somebody. Amen. Genesis chapter 3. We begin from verse 1 because now, remember this guy, these two people, Adam and Eve, are living in Edenic economy. They needed for nothing. they lived in the glory. I mean, God came to visit them every day in the cool of the evening. In the Ruach, the Bible says the Ruach, and I mean the breath of God would come. It was a cool breeze that would come in there to, of God's presence every day. That's what they hosted. Now here comes Satan, and here's what happens. Now the serpent was more cunning than any of the beasts of the field, which the Lord God had made. Now notice that the serpent was a creature made by God. Okay, and this is, in other words, Satan didn't make the snake. Today we have a reference, because of the fall of Adam and the association of the fall of man with the snake has just a bad branding. Okay, but there was a time when the snake was an asset within the economy of glory. Talk to me, somebody. Satan did not make the snake. So if divine foreknowledge, if divine genius makes the snake, then the snake is supposed to be part of the economy of glory. As a matter of fact, Jesus in redemption, telling you, because he's a redeemer, he redeems all things, right? Jesus redeems all things, including the snake. That's why he said to you, be as wise as what? Serpent. There was something the serpent was given that is needed for your generation. If you don't have what the snake was given as a gift, you are gonna be eaten, and you'll be on the menu of the power brokers of your day if you are not as shrewd as a serpent. And then in your heart be harmless as a dove, but on the exterior, when you are in that boardroom, you are in that government, whatever, talk to me. Nobody likes you. Everybody wants to eat your lunch. Talk to me, somebody. They don't care that you're going to go end up on Facebook crying, how can he do this to me? Why are you saying, how can you do this to me? They are moving to the next deal floor. And you just become the menu of the last deal because you are so naive. Christians are so naive in the table in business. One of the things I do, and I'm trying to help Christians in business, is allow God to destroy this naivety, this Christian naivety, because Jesus never taught us to appear in business like he said, in your heart be as harmless as a dove, but your exterior has to be of a snake. It has to be. That's what the snake was given, a cunningness, a shrewdness. Why would the Satan, understand, Satan was looking for a tactical advantage against Eve and Adam. He wanted to change a dynamic within the ecosystem of their connection to God. And so coming in the garden, he was at a disadvantage, and you're going to see why. You know, that the reason he was at a disadvantage was because of the kind of eyes God gave them. You know, God gave them. You know, talk to me, somebody. You see, God promised them, you know, God has, God has integrity, is that right? Integrity means if I say something, I'm going to do exactly what I said. You know, God said, let us make man. Is that right? After our image, after our likeness. Is that right? You know, he said, let us make man. Okay? After our image, after our likeness. Okay? So the question that you have to ask ourselves, is God blind? If God is not blind, is that right? Then integrity by statement would mean that what's created exactly like God, which means when they became awake or came into consciousness, they had spiritual eyes. They could see everything God saw. So in other words, today, right now, for instance, right now, in this building, there are angels who are with us. But unfortunately, we cannot leverage that presence to its highest level because we can't see them. We can feel them. And in a little bit of times, by the special grace of God, we get to see them and go, oh my, wow. And all the fear lives if you realize the witch next door, she's the one in trouble because the angel behind you can just with a snap of his finger, he can break her neck like that. But before you are shaking when you saw was a woman with witchcraft, she's standing next to you. What you don't see is Michael behind you saying, I'm going to kill her if she touches you. Are you catching what I'm saying? So when Satan comes in the garden, I wanna present to you that there was something he was looking for. Why would he go for the serpent? The serpent was given shrewdness. What is shrewdness? Shrewdness is the ability to hide your real motivation when you are coming to the table of negotiation. The best negotiator, the best people can come in a meeting and make you fight over what they don't want. And when they have raised enough emotion around what they don't want, then they say, okay, you know what? Since you have argued so much on this thing, why don't you just give me 5% equity in that company? That's what they were after all the time. He said, okay, I'll give you that. And they laugh. Oh, I got the deal. He said, no, I never wanted that deal. It was that what I wanted. But because I'm shrewd, you could not see me coming. He needed a creature already gifted enough to hide his real agenda by its very making. And the serpent was given that divine design. It was shrewd. If people can see you coming, you're not shrewd. So he went and took advantage of what was already built, what was by design a gift of God to the serpent. We find that the serpent was talking to the woman, is right? How many know if a snake right now talked to you, how many of you be sitting right there? You'll be jumping and prophesying in the air. You'll discover that you're an acrobat. Talk to me, somebody. Amen? Just by the adrenaline that will come through your... You'll be like, hallelujah. Come on, somebody. Who'll be catching you from the air? What happened? A snake just talked to me. Why was Eve not frightened? Because the human response would be this. If a snake speaks to you, hello, Susie. You're not going to say, oh, that's cute. The cobra called me Susie. No, you are freaking out. Because in your frame of reference, snakes don't talk to people. Why is Eve not bothered by the talking serpent? Because the serpent in the garden is different from the serpent you know today. The serpent you know today is a symbol of judgment. The serpent of glory could speak. Talk to me, somebody. I get what I'm saying. The serpent, what? Could speak. Is that right? That's why for Eve, this was not unusual. If it was unusual, our reaction would have been different. So watch this. The rabbi said, now this is even proven in Judeo studies. They know that the serpent of old used to speak. It had the ability for speech of all the creatures. Of all the creatures. Come on, somebody. Now watch this. And so he borrowed the body because, remember, by the law of dominion, spirits without bodies are illegal on earth. So Satan had to borrow something with the body. And the serpent had the body. And now he inhabited the serpent. The judgment of the serpent from the Lord was, why would you borrow your body to Satan so that he could deceive my daughter? From today, I'm cutting off your legs. By the way, the serpents of the Bible used to have legs. Now scientists have found two legs on every skin of a serpent today. Meaning that there was once legs on the serpent. Isn't the Bible amazing? You know, and so watch this. But I want to show you what did he come in the garden for? Because whatever he came in the garden for is what is the number one reason he keeps coming to your garden of destiny. And if you're not shrewd enough to understand what he's really looking after, talk to me, somebody. Amen. You are going to keep giving him your lunch because you're going to keep giving him your lunch, you know, because you are so focused, amen, on the orange, you don't see what he really wanted was this. Amen? So watch what happens here, and let's go through it very quickly. Thank you, Jesus. Is this a good confession for the morning? Amen? Talk to me, somebody. And the woman said to he said to the woman, has God's, you know, soldiers. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord had made. And he said to the woman, that word he said, that Satan in the snake speaking to the woman. So there was a he inside the snake. And he said to the woman, God has indeed said, shall you not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, watch this. We may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God said, you shall not eat of it. Now shall you touch it, lest you die. Okay? And then the serpent said to the woman, watch this now. Surely you will not die. For God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be open. Your eyes will be open. And you shall be like God, knowing good and evil. Knowing good and evil. So literally, he starts the conversation about the eating of the tree, but what is really after is opening their eyes. Now the question comes to mind. If Satan is after opening their eyes, were they blind? Because usually you can be, well, why? What if Satan is offering them the opening of their eyes, the question remains, were they blind? And in my study, I found out something. That Adam and Eve in the order of creation, when they were in glory, before they fell, they were physically blind. The reason they were physically blind is because their physical eyes was a plan B status. God never intended for them to use their physical eyes, because why do you need physical eyes when you can see like God? So in, you know, every programmer knows to build a default system in a program. That if this fails, this system, when this protocol is opened up, that means the original system has failed. So God never wanted them to see with the eyes you see with now, because he understood the curse that would come with your with the curious case of your physical eyes. God knew that there are issues now of understanding. The energy of understanding, the energy of communication is going to slow down. Because now, what your spiritual eyes accept as a spirituality and can begin to move in that direction, your eyes in the natural will question for 5 years before they believe. So Satan was looking down to slow down the technology of engagement between the scalpel and the divine. Satan understood, as a spirit who wants to take over their world, because I've been cast out of heaven, I am at a tactical advantage if they retain the eyes that can see me coming. The eyes they had were eyes of dominion, so they could see what God saw. It's a reason they never had an issue with being naked, because they were not naked. They were covered with Shekinah, glory. And the eyes they had could see glory. The eyes you now don't see glory. So they could see Shekinah. So when the woman looked at herself, what did she see? A garment of glory. The same garments that will be returned to you when you get to heaven. Nobody's naked in heaven. They're just covered with different clothes. So they had garments of glory. That's why when they told God we are naked, God knew, oh my God, the default protocol is now in place. If you and tell me you are naked from a natural perspective, it means the product is malfunctioning already and it's already in a default status. And the default status is that of going through life using your physical eyes trying to judge spiritual things. Oh my God, what a problem this is. Because now the natural must become the adjudicator of the supernatural. Do you see the problem with that? Do you see the problem with that? You get what I'm saying? So your spiritual eyes can look at your Naira bank account that says 1,000 Naira is all you've got, but your spiritual eyes can see $1 million because that's in what in your profile in heaven. But not to convince your natural eyes to congruate, to convince your natural eyes to move from your Naira account to your heavenly account can take 5 years. And in between, all kind of borrowing from people. By the time you get to where God has your blessing for you, you are using the blessing to pay off the people that you borrowed money from because you couldn't wait on the Lord. And the reason why it took long for God to manifest your $1 million in your heavenly account, because it took him 20 years to get you to see the same thing. See, Satan was after, and I said, God, why the tree? Why is he after them eating the tree? And then God told me something. He said, because Satan knew something. He says, the code. See, I like to speak in programming language. Sometimes I spend too much time with programmers, okay? God told me that because the code, someone say the code. The code to unlock their spiritual eyes was in the tree. Have you noticed in technology that if you go to buy a software, sometimes, listen to those guys, because you are a filming church, so you probably use a lot of software that is for video production. Most owners of that technology, you know what they do? They want you to have it. So they allow you to download it, but when you download it, there's a thing they send you later in an email called a licensing key. Is that right? If you have the technology on your computer, amen? When you try to access it, it will be fighting for an access key. The technology, the whole technology of the video production, editing, all the nuances of editing are already on your software, inaccessible until the license key is put in. God put the licensing key for the opening of the protocols of your natural eyes in the tree. They already had the physical eyes, but they were blind. They were functionally useless, unused, just unused. Why? Because God never ever intended for you to use them, but being a God of foreknowledge, knowing how hard-headed man can be, he built a default status. If you can't see me, at least I want you to see where your lamp is, where your hand is. But the problem with that kind of sight is every time I begin to use a man, we may spend 10 years me asking the same woman, what do you see? I didn't have to ask that of Adam and Eve. Because in glory, they saw what I saw. So the speed of transaction was like that. So if you are driving around Lagos and God says, that's your building. You say, thank you, Jesus. And because in that, the eyes they had were eyes of dominion. What they saw, their eyes possessed. In other words, the eyes they had were doing in the spirit what your hands do now. Their eyes were their hands. Whatever they saw, they possessed by sight. But now it's not enough to see. It will take a while for you to hold it. Because the technology has slowed down. Amen. In internet, it will be like going from 5G. You remember dial-up? Come on, some of you, I know. Are some of you older than, don't make me feel old. I can't be the only one who's old at Fountain of Life who understand when internet started. You remember that? The whole office would be around the code. Is this the code not coming in? Hold it. Because it was dialed up and then you dialed the phone. It was dialed up. It was the lowest speed of what the internet. Broadband. Now we've got 5G. It's super speed. Is that right? Versus dial-up. You know what I'm saying? So Satan understood, and then God showed me something that was very powerful. Somebody catching this? Talk to your neighbor, what do you see? What do you really see? I came from a culture of lack. In 1989, when I got born again, I was so poor in my village, in the township I lived. Now, this is a township of poor people, okay? Ain't nobody rich in this township, I'm telling you. The very fact that you are living in that town is an indictment against your prosperity. But sometimes in the kingdom of the blind, one man with a little bit of sight is a king. So I lived in a poor township. Amen? In my language, it's called Chimwemwe, which means joy. There was nothing to be joy about, I'm telling you. That's the truth. But they call it Chimwemwe. I was so poor, when poor people saw me, they got encouraged. They're like, my God, I thought I was doing bad until I saw this brother. God bless him, Jesus. Kuraba Katoro, I begin to pray for you. What I'm saying is, in a culture like that, lack was built into the system. You fasted. And we had so many involuntary fasts. Not because we wanted to fast, because there was no food for the next 3 days. So to spiritualize the experience, we fasted. I found that when I made it a fast, my brother, the hunger strike was much better. Does that make sense? Because I made it spiritual. What I would do something with it. My point is, I did not know that the enemy was mentoring and conditioning my sight to see lack everywhere. So what do you think was the warfare God entered with me when he raised me? It had nothing to do with witches. Yeah, they were still there. But I have bad dreams sometimes, whatever. But to God, that is not as powerful as me changing how you see. Because if you keep seeing lack every time, knowing the dynamics of the spirit, you get more of the same. So watch what happens here. Is that the Bible, let me just finish it and I'm going to jump to two more scriptures. Are you enjoying this? This is easy morning, cool breeze kind of teaching. Is that all good? Is this good enough for you guys? Do you want more? Okay, let's go through it. So watch this. Knowing good and evil. Verse 6, so when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of the fruit and ate it. She also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. She gave to her husband with her, and what? He ate. This is where you are now. Open up what I call the curse of the curious case of the physical eyes. He ate. Then the eyes of both of them were opened. The eyes of what? Both of them were opened. Is that right? That means there was a short season when one had spiritual eyes, and the other one had entered the realm of physical eyes. The Lord told me something, a dichotomy that happens in marriage and it happens in ministry. He said to me, one of the curse that comes with the curious case of our physical eyes is this. That once we are in that state of where we are driven by our physical eyes, we have a lust and an appetite for everyone around us to see what we see. Because we begin to think they don't see what we see, they're not being reasonable. So in marriage, this is how it looks like. Your husband is seen by the eyes of faith. Yes, your Naira account, Mama, says you got a 10,000 Naira. That's not a lot of money. You're in trouble in the natural. So, but he realizes if we stay in the natural, we are all sinking in the same toilet. But I'm in faith. Honey, don't worry, baby. God's going to provide. What kind of husband are you? You can't see what I see. In other words, the invitation is, I'm not going to let you go until you see what I see. Then, you know, then when you meet, I don't know what's wrong with my husband. He's always talking faith. I don't eat faith. I want to be practical. We got to be real here. You know, one day the husband healed. Yes, baby. Yeah, things are really bad. Yeah, we're only going 10,000 rider. Ah, now you can see. Oh, he cares. Well, he cares now, but both are now in the same territory where now you are victims of the curious case of your physical eyes. You know, because what you see is not the reality as things stand in heaven. The goal I'm trying to get to is this. I'm going to show you that in the realm of light, there is a level of elevation you're about to step into where blindness will be your greatest gift from God. And I'm going to show you as I come to the conclusion of this. But when the eyes are opened, already trouble begins. They can't even process because your physical eyes, you see, those spiritual eyes not only could see, but they were perceptive in divine nature. That means if they saw a lion, their eyes taught them this is a pet. When they change eyes, when you see a lion, you see yourself as lunch. And you begin to be afraid of what you dominated because your eyes are already telling you you are about to be eaten. So when you see the lion, before it even begins to run, you are finding a tree. Because you already are convinced I'm lunch. They live with lions and tigers every day and they saw them as pets because their eyes were eyes of dominion. They saw animals, they saw everything from God's perspective. And from God's perspective, hello Daniel, lions are not supposed to eat you. From God's perspective, our lions are supposed to bow down. And that's why Daniel survived the lion's den. Talk to me somebody. Oh, hallelujah. What am I trying to say? I'm saying in this kingdom, there are people who are becoming blind again so they can see. Talk to me, somebody. There are people in this kingdom that are becoming blind again. We need to become blind again. Because if Jesus is the last Adam and is a restorer of all things, if the original state of your physical eyes is that they were decorative. Your eyes were decorative in glory. Jesus, then, if he's the last Adam, must bring your eye, physical eyes, to a decorative status. To allow you to enjoy how you look, but not determine how you see. You can say, I look good, baby. Talk to me, somebody. Or talk to me, somebody. Amen. But if you don't look good, you don't have the right suit on, you can still say, well, I don't like the suit. But that's where it ends, baby. Because I'm not going to let the suit define who I am. Because what I'm seeing a future in which I own a bank in Nigeria. So my clothes are going to change because I see a bank that I'm going to own. So hey, baby, my spiritual father, Miles Monroe, used to say it this way. Eyes that look are common, but eyes that see are rare. Your eyes are supposed to become decorative in glory. How many want your eyes to become decorative? Decorative means decorative means your eyes will no longer be invited to the table of negotiation with God. What am I talking about? Let me show you how powerful this thing is. Amen? Well, let's turn you in your Bibles very quickly. Let's move away from this. Let's move away from this. Very, very quickly, go to something Jesus said that I never understood until now. Now I understand what Yeshua was talking about. I never understood. Okay? Matthew 13. Come on, Fountain of Life Church. Amen. Man, I love this church so much. I need some membership cards right now. Jimmy, I can sign. I may be default member traveling all over the world, but you know, I just want to. Come on, somebody. Amen. I'm serious. Genesis 13, verse 14. Are you there, saints? Are you there? Amen. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, the Lord is about to bless you with blindness. And I tell them, for there is a level in this kingdom. For there is a level of light in this kingdom where blindness will be God's greatest gift to you. So now Jesus turns here. Matthew 13. Can I bring it home? Now I'm going to bring it home. Matthew 13 from verse 14. And in them, watch now, there's a prophecy concerning this. In them, the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled, which says, hearing you will hear and shall not understand. Seeing you will see and not perceive. Okay? Hearing you hear. That means, look, tell me something. When their ear, here's what I'm like. The eyes and the ears were connected. By the way, when God said you shall die, God called the discovery of your physical eyes death. In the day you eat of it, you discover death. Why? Because God considers living life by what you see with your physical eyes, death. That's death. That's why Lot chose Sodom, not knowing Sodom would be judged by fire, and he'll leave Sodom bankrupt and sleep with his daughter, will be the end of his legacy. Do you honestly believe if Lot saw all of that with the eyes of the Spirit, he would have moved towards Sodom? Why did he move? The Bible says because Sodom at the time looked fatal. The curse of the curious case of your physical eyes. It will always lead you. Talk to me, somebody. That's why. Come on, somebody. Amen. Amen. That's why God could be giving you a godly husband who's going to dominate Nigeria in the ministry space. But the first time he arrived to Fountain of Life, he was like Francis Miles. I arrived in church with one trouser, one t-shirt, and shoes that were prophesying. At the time, if I'd proposed any of my sisters, they would have looked at me like this. They say, no, thank you. No, thank you. No, thank you. They would not know. They were saying no to Francis Miles. They were saying no. Can you believe that? They would say no to Francis Miles. Now I talk to governments. I do all kinds of things. I've got money coming through my ears. Don't be jealous. Just say thank you, Jesus. But I'm saying that many sisters looked at me and they didn't see me as a potential suitor. They saw me as a prayer case. This is the curse. This is the curse of the curious case of your physical eyes. That even when blessing enters your door, you will reject it because your physical eyes do not see. This is how God can bless me. My God. I went to Harvard. Why am I working there? And God says, no. Because in 3 months, the owner is about to give you the company. Ah, no. I don't even like the salary scale. I don't whatever. No one asking, God, where are you in this? Because maybe what you never thought is the very thing that changes everything. Are you with me, somebody? So Jesus is saying this very quickly. He's saying this. He says, herein is the prophecy of Isaiah fulfilled. Hearing you do not understand. Seeing you shall not perceive. Meaning, their original eyes could see and perceive instantly. So the spiritual eyes of dominion they had would look at a poor man and see a Joshua Selman 5 years. And then make quality decisions in the now. Yes, I can see it. Do you know how many of you women would be married to powerful men if you could see that? How many of you men would be married to the right woman? Because you could see that. Talk to me, somebody. But what do we go by? How does it look? Does he have Louis Vuitton in his feet? What you don't know, that Louis Vuitton is the last Louis Vuitton you ever wear. Actually, the man who's looking good when you meet him is on his way back. So you are marrying a train on the down road. And your physical eyes got you there while everything spirit is screaming, don't do it! Don't do it! He says, having eyes, for the hearts of these people are grown down. Their ears are hard of hearing. Their eyes, they have closed. Lest they should see with their eyes. What eyes is he talking about? Their original eyes of dominion. Because the Lord spoke to me something, a mystery. He said, Francis, the way I designed you is I knew the day your physical eyes opened, Satan knew this. That the licensing key from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil that open and activate your spiritual eyes simultaneously close your spiritual eyes because you couldn't have it both. So if Yeshua is the last Adam, he must reverse the cycle. He must make you blind so you can see again. He must make you blind so you can what? See again. He says, watch what he says. He says, their eyes have closed. And then he says, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears, lest they should understand with their hearts and turn so I should heal them. And then he ends by saying, blessed are you who see. Blessed are your eyes for they see and your ears for they hear. That part he was talking to his own disciples. Because you have come to me, it was a tree that which was eating in a tree that caused their eyes to be closed and their original eyes to be closed and they defaulted to the lowest eyes a spirit can have, which is physical eyes. But I am the last tree. If you eat in me, I'll close your physical eyes. And the way you walk, people won't understand you. Because people say, can't you see? Can't you see? Can't you see you have no money? How can you not have money? Can't you see? The accountants won't even understand you. They'll say, but Pastor, I don't understand. Why are we building a new church? We've only got 100,000 naira. You see, because that's what they can see. But you are moving forward because you have now become blind again. So you can see only what God says. Now let me tell you how this looks like. How many know of a guy called Jesse Duplantis? Ever heard of a Jesse Duplantis? Jesse Duplantis lives in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Got a great ministry out of there. And Jesse was coming from a trip somewhere within Louisiana. And he said he drove through New Orleans. Now he doesn't live in New Orleans. He was going on his way to Baton Rouge. And as he's driving, he passed through a very rough neighborhood. Rough, what we in America call the hood, okay? You know, when you see the hood in America, I don't care where you're coming from. If you're coming from Africa, from Israel, you don't want to live in the hood, okay? It's infested with poverty, is the configuration of the hood, plus violence and all that kind of stuff. So he passed, because it was a shortcut, he passed with his driver. And then he saw this dilapidated, massive warehouse building. It looked so awkward, so bad. In a town he has nothing to do with. But if you know Baton Rouge, a different suburb, he has ministry there. He flies in and out. He just happened to be driving this time and he brought to New Orleans. Jesse says, as I was driving by this bad better building, I heard the Lord said, Jesse, say, yes, Lord, buy it. That's your building. Now, do you know what your curse of the physical eyes mean of us? I said, what? I ain't buying that thing. Look at that thing. And on top of that, Lord, I don't even live here. This is the hood, and it's ugly, it's dusty. You can see what's around it. Jesse just called his accountant on the crying guy. Said, "Hello." He told, "I found a big building. It's still up there. You get it for almost nothing." He said, "God told me when I was passing by, it's my building. You buy it right away. I don't care what it costs. Just buy it. It's gonna be negotiate. Buy it." The accountants, they looked for it. They went and bought it for cheap. Because who wanted a building that bad in the hood? And they brought the titles to Jesse. Said, Jesse, this is the bad. Man, it's bad. It's a bad. Oh, God, it's bad. But hey, you said God told you. Here are the titles. You are now the beautiful owner of a bad building in the hood. He said, yeah, no, Jesus gave it me. He said, Jesus took the titles, put them in his glove compartment, or put them in a tray of his office, never looked them again. Until 5 years later, a phone call came from the office of the mayor of New Orleans. Hello, Jesse, we've been looking at title. We did the title search. We found out you own a building in New Orleans, in this title town. Can we talk? And Jesse said, oh, I began to get excited. I said, oh, thank you, Jesus. That's what you told me. Talk to me now. He said, what do you, he says, well, so he told his people, find out what they're about to do. So they found out, you know, Jesse, I was not going to deal quickly. Because when the mayor is calling you, they're up to something big. And don't negotiate before you know what they're trying to do. So he had his people investigate, and the city of New Orleans was about to do a multi-million dollar renovation of that area, and there was going to be things passing through there. When he saw the plans and realized the value of the plans to the city, he said, now they can call me. Yeah, I own that building. What do you want? What do you want? What do you want? He ended up selling the building for 0.5 to $4 million, I think he picked up for less than $100,000. He never lived in it, but made over $3 million profit on a building in a bad part of town, because blessed are you who see. Blessed are you who can hear. This I'm finding now is a challenge of destiny for all of us. Turn to your neighbor and say, what do you see? And tell them, is what you are seeing lifting you up or keeping you in the same place? Stand up, everyone. We're going to pray for you. Did you receive that? Did you receive that, people? Fountain of Life Church. I can tell you, my biggest battle with God has been over what do you see. Very rarely does God ever argue with me about theology. Our fight is about what do you see? What do you see? I'll give you a testimony. If Pastor Jim will allow me to have 2 minutes. 2 5-minutes. Just increased. When you see that kind of grace, you increase your limit to 5 minutes. People have always asked me, Donna Miles, how did you end up where you are now? Because it's amazing what the Lord has done with my ministry in America. Dr. Kunle knows. You know, for some people, America is a place where they go and get a new life and pay some bills and things change. And I appreciate that. But I'm a changer. I'm a global changer. Putting food on the table, if that's all America is for me, it's death to me. I'm a changer. I'm a changer of nations. That's what I saw. It's what God promised me. So, but here's how it came. I'm talking about the curse of the curious case of your physical eyes. Jesus told the Pharisees, he said, I wish you were blind. Because if you are blind, then I would heal you. But since you claim to see, your sins are now with you. He told them that. That's a judgment. He says, I wish you were blind. What was he saying? There is a level of light where blindness is a blessing to you. As a matter of fact, let me just say this very quickly in a minute. In John chapter 9, go home and study it. Jesus passes by and sees a blind man. And there's something unique about this blind man, because healing the blind was not unique to Jesus. Blind eyes open every day. There was only one blind man Jesus opened where the word glory was attached to his blindness. For every blind person, blindness was their blindness was a handicap within their physical condition. So in that economy, if you're blind physically, you are useless in many things. So it was mercy for God to heal their blind eyes. So the disciples got used to blindness being a handicap. They got used to blindness being a curse, a handicap. So one day they see this blind man and they ask Jesus a theological question based upon prior experience. They said, Lord, who sinned? This man or his parents? Because in their eyes, if he's blind, he's cursed. Somebody committed a serious iniquity. And Jesus surprises them with only this one blind man. He said, no, 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 no. This is my favorite blind man because it's my prophecy to a generation that thinks they can see but are blind. So his blindness is a gift to his generation. So he says, no, this one, his blindness has nothing to do with the curse. His mother didn't sin, neither did he sin. But his blindness is for the glory of God. How can blindness for the glory? You think that there's a level where blindness works to the glory of God. So they brought the blind man and he heals them. And he tells them, go and wash your eyes in a pool of Siloam. He goes to wash it. He's the only one he healed this way. And Siloam means sent one. What he's saying is go, but when your eyes open, it's not your physical eyes that are just opening. They just say, will be a testament because the Siloam means sent. I'm going to give you the eyes of anyone I'm sending. If anyone I'm sending to a generation doesn't see like you see, they are a lost cause in kingdom advancement. The moment his eyes open, you know, now you know, the moment open, the moment he's the only blind man that is the moment his eyes open, the Lord put him in the middle of the Sanhedrin council to argue theology. How does it, he ends, they bring him, they say, okay, we see you're blind. Who made you? If you look at that story, the next 20 scriptures is the blind man arguing with scholars. And the more he argued, the more he proved the scholars were the blindest in the society. They said, who opened your eyes? He said, Jesus. No, we know he's a sinner. We said, I don't know if he's a sinner. Oh, I know. He opened his eyes. Then he began to talk. Said, oh, guys, you guys seem interested. Are you trying to be his disciples? Now he's trying to. He said, no, we can't be. We're disciples of Moses. So the more they speak, the more they indict themselves. The blind man could see Jesus. The scholars who led Torah every day couldn't see Messiah right in front of them. I believe God is about to do something. God is about to make you blind again. What do I mean? Amen? Everything supernatural, men who are doing big things, if they told you their story, they did it with having to shut their physical eyes every day because everything around them told them this can't be done. Ask the Maurice Oruros. Talk to me, somebody. Ask these guys. Ask Baba. If I'm telling you, I don't have to be there. You know, in January, I had the privilege of spending 25 minutes in his office with Baba David Oyedepo. You know, and he told me something. My son, everybody thinks meeting me is all it takes. But you know, my son, the secrets of the fathers are in their writings. Eat my writings. Eat my writings. I love them. I ate Kenneth Copeland. I ate Till Osborne. Until I began to see what nobody else can see. Sense. You don't build Canaanland 3 hours out of Lagos in a bush and build such a city because your natural eyes encourage you to do so. At some level, he became blind. He became blind to the advice of elders who use eyes to judge ministry. This is the dilemma of people of ministry like Jimmy, who have been called to craft a new day, but they're surrounded by people who have the curious case of their physical eyes. And what is what happens? And what do I mean, Dr. Miles? Elijah and Elisha are walking. Elisha is about to go. A transition of mantles is about to happen. Talk to me, somebody. Are you catching what I'm saying? Watching at the distance at the disciples, not of Elisha, but of Elijah. So their sight has been conditioned to the era of Elijah. Because even when you are spiritual, your eyes get conditioned to a certain level of ambience of ministry and success. But at the moment of transition, you need the gift of blindness or you won't follow the next Elisha. So what happens now is Elijah is all the sons of the prophets have known. They know his anointing. They know what he does. But Elijah himself knows my era has come to an end. I'm about to hand my mantle to Elisha. And they are walking together. So he's testing Elisha at every point, at Gilgal, at Jericho. He tells them, leave me, because he wants to see the level of attachment the man has to the mantle. The guy says, as my soul liveth, while you are still alive, I'm not going to let you out of my sight. They kept going. Finally, he passed every test. Because every mantle has a character. Oh my God. Every mantle has a character requirement. Every mantle, whatever. And all of a sudden, don't think Jimmy Odukoya is on the pulpit because he is the son of your founder. The devil is a liar. God does not transfer mantles based on family ties. God transfers mantles based on family, on revelation. The only economy of glory is revelation. So finally they get to the place coolly where the mantle must pass. Where the mantle must pass. And the father turns to the son. Elisha, I can hear the chariots coming. I can hear the chariots coming. What must I now do for you, seeing you are the next level of my ministry? And now, he says this, I want a double portion of your spirit. Not your anointing. We always read that wrong. Because the young man came to understand that there was something about the spirit of the father, this God respected. If I can have a double of that, then it goes without saying that his anointing would double. Because of a double of the same spirit, God has been honoring. I want the double portion of your spirit. Because when I go back to my generation, I don't want to give them another spirit. My administration will be different. The nuances of my means will be different. But it will be the same water they have been drinking at a double level. Because it's your spirit I'm asking for. So Elijah turned around and he must have smiled. Like every mentor knows, my ministry is safe. Its legacy will be a double portion, not going down. And he said, but here's the problem. At the moment of transfer, I'm not the final signature. Because the spirit, the God who gave me this mantle, has a final test. He says, if you see me. Because he must ask you the Jeremiah question. What do you see? If you see me going, then the one who operates with men at the level of seeing will now give you the mantle. Because if you, so now Elisha's final test has nothing to do with Elijah. It has everything to do with God and him. That's why when the chariots came, the Bible says Elisha saw them. And he screamed, my father, the chariots of Israel. Watch this. And the Bible says, at the moment of sight, the mantle fell. Because in the eyes they had before they fell, eyes were for possession. What you saw, you heard. When he saw, the mantle fell on him. Now here is a dilemma of ministry. When Elijah lives, here's what you don't see. That the prophets were just 100 meters away. And they never saw the chariot. The school of the prophets, which in reality were the custodian of the Elijah ministry, never saw what Elisha saw. That means they failed the test of sight. So they could not appreciate the transition that just happened. And it's proven when Elisha comes back, he tries to demonstrate. He gets to the water jug. He says, where is the God of Elijah? He hits the mantle. It parts. Now you understand. He's trying to show them. If the mantle of Elijah is with Elisha, there is no way Elijah is still in town. Because no two people can expire the same mantle at the same time. So he crosses over. But what do the elders, the board of the Elijah ministry has taken over, say to him? They say to him, Elisha, you went with our father. You came back alone. And yes, he said, yes, God, the chariot of Israel, I've taken my father and the mantle is on me. They don't say, amen. No. They said, do you want us to go and look everywhere lest the Spirit of God has dropped them in a different geography? So the ministry of Elisha is delayed. He's delayed from starting because he had to wait for those with physical eyes in ministry to authenticate that he can move on. Notice there now that Elijah sits there frustrated because he understands that mantle is gone. A new mantle has arrived. It's on me, but in a different ambience, because I've got double of what he had. Something is happening with me. I just showed you I can do what he used to do. But to honor the past, I'm going to sit around and wait for you, go on a useless physical search for the man the heavens have taken. And the Bible says all the prophets went in all four corners of the earth looking for the man heaven had received. This is the curse of the physical earth. Every visionary has to fight the people around them because they can't see the next level. Maybe they saw the first level. The problem of sight is God does not judge your sight for one level. At every transition of season, your eyes will be checked again, because what you saw yesterday can become an enemy of the next thing that's coming. So if you are blind, it doesn't mind that you are awake when Fountain of Life started. Are you awake to the next level of the ministry? Because if you're not awake to that, you become its biggest problem, because I don't see. You keep saying, I don't see it. I don't see it. We used to, I don't see it. And God said, that is the problem, because you are now using the physical eyes and the curse that comes with them. And the curse of the physical eyes is slowing down divine energy for the comfortability of the flesh. Let's slow it down. We don't have to be fast, because I don't see it. And until I see it, this was the curious case of an apostle who saw miracles, signs, and wonders. So Jesus raised Lazarus, but when Jesus, who raised Lazarus, was taught to him that the man who raised a dead man after 4 days has himself risen, he says, I won't believe it until I touch his hands. I won't believe it until he comes to me and presents himself. And Jesus, out of mercy, appeared to John, to Thomas. He said, Thomas, come and touch me. But if you are touching me, the frequency of your apostleship is so low, I can't use you in changing nations. Because if every time you have to check the divine with the natural to verify it, at that level of speed, I'll do nothing with your life. For blessed is he who believes, before they can see. Pray in tongues. Ask God to let you see. Ask the Lord to open your eyes to the next season of Fountain of Life. Come on, pray for yourself. Say, God, I want to be an asset. Tell God, I want to be an asset. I want to be an asset to Elisha. Lord, I want to be an asset to Elisha. I was here 32 years ago when Elijah began the ministry. But I'm here for Elisha, Lord. Open my eyes that I can help Elisha. Open my eyes that I can be useful in the days of Elisha. In the name of, come on, pray right now. Ask God to make you useful in the days of Elisha. Yes, you are God. God honors your sacrifice in the days of Elijah. But he says, I am the God of Elisha as well. Would you enter with me into a new season where we'll do things Fountain of Life has never done? In the name of Jesus. But it's the same spirit. It's the same water at a different frequency, at a different energy, at a different ambience. Can you see it? In the name of Jesus. Come on, pray. You are praying for yourself. You are praying to be repositioned. Ask the Lord to reposition you for a new Fountain of Life church. In the name of Jesus. God wants to use you like he used you for 32 years. He wants to use you like that for the next 32 years. Following an Elisha, who's going to see double the miracles. Double the miracles of Elijah. God is having you follow an Elisha who do double. Because you see, the Elisha is building from the shoulders of Elijah and upwards. So it's going to be double. He's going to see at elevation the Elijahs cannot see. Because when you are standing on the shoulders of a father, you see further than the father. But at the father not risen, you wouldn't see the way you see. But now join him at a higher form of revelation, at a higher form of sight. See, talk to me, somebody. So when people ask you, why is Elijah doing what it's doing. And you say, baby, just go and wash your eyes in the pool of Siloam and you are going to see what Jimmy is doing. Just go and wash your eyes. Have Jesus wash your eyes and the blindness to the new season will disappear and you will see that fountain of life has moved to a whole new level. New level. Double your giving. Double your commitment, because the era of double portion required double of everything. Double your tithing, double your giving, double your commitment, double your engagement. It's a new season of Elisha in the house. Yeke terebo saka. Maraba manturiete. Lebo marimu. Lende marimu sakariana babie. Yele bekonto. Shalamando robosike. Oh, Rabba Kata Rabba. Let's pray for all our brothers and sisters who are going to join us tonight, who are not part, who are part of Fountain of Life. Pray for the same anointing. And even while they are at work, God will be sending all of them to the pool of Siloam so they can see with new eyes of a new Elisha. They can come and re-engage like never before. They'll come and run like never before. In the name of Jesus. Ikarabamando robosata. Erebeka rubashata. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I believe in activation. I'll end with this and give up the mic. Say, Heavenly Father, righteous judge, I give you the permission. Judge my eyes to the degree that I'm blind to what you are doing with Elisha. Help me to see. I don't want to be one of the sons of the prophets, loyal to Elijah, but cannot see that a new era has begun that will sustain the legacy of Elijah while moving forward to greater heights. Open my eyes. Give me the gift of blindness to natural things that are trying to steal my attention and my commitment to the vision. Make me blind to those things that I can only see what you are doing in the house, the new things you are doing in the house. The former things have come and gone, but a new day is upon us, and I don't want to be irrelevant in a new season. Give me the language of this new era, the hearing ears of this new era, the seeing eyes of this new era, that I may be a gift to this house for another 32 years, should the Lord tarry. I want to be a gift to strengthening this church to become bigger and better in the name of Jesus. Lying behind the vision, the nuances, the personality of Elisha in the name of Jesus. God, I give you praise. Thank you, Lord. In my own journey, I ask you, God, make me blind to everything Satan has sent to bewitch me from success. Blind me. Blind me from satanic evidences. And give me the gift of blindness to those things. Like young Jeremiah, I want to see what you see about my life, that you may perform your word concerning me and my generation. In Jesus' name, give God a shout.
Hallelujah! Let somebody give a shout of hallelujah! Hallelujah! Wow! Wow! The first thing I'm going to say, tell everybody you know, they have to watch this service. Every single person you know, those of us that are here, we're watching, but those that were not here, either physically or online, please, do them a favor. Just keep in. It's every session we're watching again. But we cannot have eaten of this delicious meal and say nothing. And I'm going to say something. by the special grace of God, we see and appreciate a new Elisha. From day one, there was never a doubt. That is the new day. That is the new day. And they have the backing. They have the backing of the entire church. Some of us have been here for a long time. I've been here for 31 years. And I had no doubt in my mind from day one that this is our new Elisha. And as the days progressed, it became clear and clearer and clearer and clearer. More than a double portion. So just in case you're visiting with us for the first time today, or just in case you've always sat on the fence, not quite sure what is happening, without a doubt, without a doubt, Elisha is here. Give the Lord a loud shout. I was near tears then. I said, God, why are you so faithful? Why are you so faithful? God loves us specially, guys. Especially. We honor you, sir. Just give a wave offering to the Lord. No life can remain the same. Please, I beg of you. I beg of you. Tell everyone you know. They have to watch this service. Over and over and over again. Father, we bless you. Father, we honor you. Father, we adore you. Blessed be your holy name. Please bring out your offering. We encourage you. You've heard it. Well, by Holy Spirit's Wayo, we know it's Bishop Bismarck tonight. Because, you know, Pastor Jimmy was not going to tell us, which is fantastic. But you see, that tells you, you know, it looked like an ordinary Tuesday morning, didn't it? But has it been an ordinary Tuesday morning? So please make sure you're at every session. And remember, we're going to go back and keep watching and keep listening. Just say something to the Lord with your offering. Father, we thank you. The privilege and the grace to give, we worship you. Blessed be your holy name. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. In Jesus' name. Could the band please... Thank you. Hallelujah. Can we please rise to our feet as we share the grace? Please remember, continues this evening at 5:30. Tomorrow, 9 a.m., 5:30. On Friday, 9 a.m., 5:30. And the grand finale will be on Sunday. Don't even begin to think that you're not going to be here on Sunday. Don't. Anyway, it is well. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely, God's goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set us free from the law of sin and death, and so sin shall not have dominion over us. For the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells inside of us, quickens our mortal bodies to the glory of his holy name. Amen.
Town Planning Way, Ilupeju, Lagos. The morning sessions will start at 9 a.m. while the evening sessions will start at 5 p.m. Don't miss this opportunity to encounter the supernatural and witness the manifestation of God's power. Word Explosion Conference of 2024, where faith meets with revelation and lives are changed forever. Tell somebody to tell somebody about it. You were created for something special, something extraordinary. Are you ready to be a sign and a wonder to your generation? The Fountain of Life Church presents Word Explosion Conference 2024. Come experience 8 days of divine revelations, transformative teachings, and powerful worship with the theme Signs and Wonders. The event holds from Sunday, April 14 to Sunday, April 21st. Speaking at the conference are renowned and seasoned preachers Bishop Mike Okonkwo, Bishop Tudor Bismarck, Dr. Francis Miles, Pastor Mike Todd, Apostle Joshua Selman, Pastor Ibukun Awoshika, and Pastor Kunle Shorinyo. Hosts are Pastor Jimmy Odukoya and Pastor Toluwani Odukoya. Venue is the Fountain of Life Church, 12 Industrial Estate Road, off Town Planning Way, Ilupeju, Lagos. The morning sessions will start at 9 a.m., while the evening sessions will start at 5 p.m. Don't miss this opportunity to encounter the supernatural and witness the manifestation of God's power. Word Explosion Conference of 2024, where faith meets with revelation and lives are changed forever. Tell somebody to tell somebody about it.
More time.
Miracle, signs, and wonders.
Still doing it. Still doing it.